There was very great silence. I have a strong suspicion. Well, maybe you're unlucky and you'll hear me. I want to thank all the sponsors, particularly Baltasar Garzón, for the courage of arranging this conference and for inviting me. The program tells me here that I'm supposed to talk to you about the experience of the Nuremberg trials. The other program on the top is universal jurisdiction and the difficult balance. So what I'll try to do is to follow the instructions. I am now in my 95th year, and I'm the only surviving prosecutor of the Nuremberg trials. So let me tell you how that came about, and then tell you a story. For the relief of those who don't like stories, if you want the details, you'll find them on my website, which is my name, Benjamin Ferencz, www.benferencz.org. You'll find there lectures, books, DVDs, motion pictures, and everything is free. So that if you fall asleep during this conference and want to make future reference to what I stand for, all you have to do is take off a few months and read my website. Now, it began with me. I was a poor immigrant boy coming from Romania, Hungary. The reason I mention both names, my sister was born in the same bed as I was a year and a half earlier. She's a Hungarian. I'm born in the same bed in the same place. I'm born in Romania. So that if there are problems about borders still today, or who's born where, it made no difference whatsoever in our lives. We came to America as poor immigrants. Without going into the details, which are on my website, I managed to get a good education, had a scholarship to the Harvard Law School for my exam on criminal law. When the United States was attacked by Japan, all the students that I knew at the law school tried to enlist in some of the military services. I was, after some difficulty, successful in getting into the Army, which made me a private at the lowest rank in the artillery, about which I knew nothing. But while in school, one of the professors was doing a book on war crimes, and I was hired to do the research, so that I was in short order. Had read everything in the Harvard Law Library and was quite knowledgeable on that subject. That, of course, had no value whatsoever as we were being trained for the invasion of France. I landed on the beaches at Normandy. I was in the artillery when we fought our way across all of France. And as we were getting closer to Germany, I was transferred to the headquarters of General Patton, where I was sent to see a colonel, and he said, "Your name has been forwarded from Washington. We are directed to set up a war crimes branch because the president, Franklin Roosevelt, as well as Churchill and Stalin, had warned the Germans that they would be held to account for the atrocities." And the colonel said to me, "What's a war crime?" They had no idea whatsoever, had never heard of crimes against humanity or aggression or things like that. So I think I was the first man in the United States Army to deal with war crimes during World War II. Well, I don't want to go into the gory details of Allied flyers who were shot down over territory occupied by then by the Americans or the British. These flyers were then almost invariably beaten to death on the ground in Germany by the German mobs. There were some exceptions. If a man landed on a farmhouse, he might have been protected by the widow who was there. My job was to get into the concentration camps as they were being liberated, and the front was moving very quickly. first camp I hit was Buchenwald, and then we went on to other camps. The names have now been forgotten by most people. In Mauthausen, there was a very large contingent, and in Flossenbürg, of Spanish nationals who had been supporters, who had been opponents of the Franco regime and had been arrested by the Germans. And they were not just executed because there was some support for the nationals, but they were worked to death, as many most people were. So I saw the horrors of the concentration camp, since there are some young people here. It's indescribable, really. Dead bodies all around, piled up like cordwood, waiting to be burned in the crematoria. Melted down into fat, used for soap, the ashes being used for fertilizer, and total chaos, the SS trying to escape, sometimes being caught by inmates who beat them to death or burned them alive, and I've seen that. And I dug up bodies with my hands. So all of the horrors of war in action and the consequences of crimes against humanity, more than you can imagine, I have witnessed and experienced firsthand. That, of course, had quite a profound effect on me. And when the war was over, I did not intend ever to go back to Germany again. However, President Roosevelt had decreed there would be war crimes trials, and he appointed one of the most respected jurists in the United States, Justice Robert Jackson, who was on the Supreme Court of the United States, to be a lead player in setting up an international military tribunal to try the principal German perpetrators of various crimes. Some of you will recall that, some of you may not. Hermann Göring was the lead defendant when he was sentenced to death. He waited a while before he could be hanged and committed suicide in his cell. Those trials had started while I was still in the Army. But I had enough time put in, about 3 years, so I went home. And with about 10 million other soldiers looking for a job. And I received a telegram from the Pentagon saying, "Dear sir," they had never called me sir in 3 years in the Army, "would I please come to Washington? They wanted to interview me for a job." I went, and I was hired then by a man who was then a colonel, later a general, Telford Taylor, who was on the staff of Jackson. The Jackson trial was continuing. I dropped in there before I left Germany, but it was just beginning. And Telford Taylor was assigned to create additional trials, 12 additional trials, because the first trial was a very meager sampling, and we were trying to explain how it's possible that a civilized country like Germany should allow and direct such atrocities. So we had a trial against the German doctors who perform medical experiments on concentration camp inmates, on the lawyers and judges who perverted the law for political purposes, on the foreign ministry, which lied to the whole world about their not wanting any more conquest, and of course to the generals and the SS stormtroopers, who were the ones on the ground who carried out the atrocities. And General Taylor said, "Look, you're experienced with as a war crimes investigator. You know the terrain." By that time, I had learned enough German to manage. "And so you go and set up a staff and find the evidence for all the other trials that we are preparing." And I did that with a staff of about 50 people. headquarters in Berlin, where we could go and go into the ruins of many of the buildings, Gestapo headquarters, Foreign Office, and try to find documentary proof. One of my researchers came out with a pile of papers in four different folders, and he said, "Look what I found." And these were reports from the Eastern Front by special squads known, when it's pronounced correctly, Einsatzgruppen. There was a word designed to be deceptive. Nobody could translate it. Einsatz means action, groups means groups, action groups. Sounds neutral. In fact, their assignment was to follow behind the German lines and then eliminate, they never used the term murder, eliminate every single Jewish man, woman, and child they could lay their hands on, do the same for the gypsies and for anybody else who was suspected of being a potential enemy against the Reich. And they reported which town they were in Ukraine or elsewhere, Crimea, and it had the name of the commanding officer and the number of people killed, for example, in a little town outside of Minsk, which is in Ukraine, got famous as Babi Yar. They managed to murder, I use the term murder because it's more accurate, to murder 33,771 Jews, according to their report, in 2 days, 29 and 30 September 1941, including thousands of children. I had descriptions of exactly how that was done during the course of the trial. My lead defendant, about whom I hope to say a few words later, he said that he never allowed his unit to do as some of them did, take the infants and smash their heads against a tree. He said, "I didn't want my men doing that, so I instructed them when a mother is carrying the infant and clinging to her breast, what you do is you aim for the infant, and then with one shot you kill them both, and the mother is quiet, and you save ammunition as well." So Mr. Ollendorf had his own view of humanitarian principles, and he was sentenced to death and hanged. However, as a result of that trial, I got some insights. But let me tell you how I got to that trial. I took that evidence and flew down from Berlin to Nuremberg. I said, "General Taylor, we have to put on a new trial." He said, "Why?" I said, "Look here, I've got piles of evidence, mass murder like you never heard of." He said, "Well, we haven't got permission from the Pentagon. We can't put on a trial like that. All of the lawyers are already assigned." I said, "Well, you can't let them go. That's impossible." And I had my degree from the Harvard Law School. I'd never tried a case. He said, "Can you do that in addition to your other work?" I said, "Sure." He said, "Okay, you're it." And so, as a matter of history, I became the chief prosecutor of what was certainly the biggest murder trial in human history. I was then 27 years old, and it was my first case. And to make it even more interesting, I arrested the prosecution's case in 2 days. They don't do it that way anymore. The defendants took about 5 months with their lies and alibis and for me to knock them out. But all 22 defendants were convicted and 13 were sentenced to death. It was a pretty good record for a first case. They weren't all executed. After a while, four of them were promptly executed. And there had been some other trials of people who were captured in the concentration camps, the guards, the commandant, who were subject to military commission trials, which didn't last long, a few minutes per defendant. And they were rushed off to Landsberg prison, which is in Bavaria, and they were executed there, about 1,000 of them, which is nobody knows about that. That was also immediately following the war. And the Holocaust Museum in Washington has photographs of me as a sergeant hanging up the sign, U.S. Military Commission, Dachau. So we had that beginning. That was my personal beginning. Of course, that also had a profound effect on me. But since I'm on the trial, let me explain the mentality of the murderers, because there's a lot of misunderstanding about them. I selected the defendants. There were 3,000 members of these Einsatzgruppen, action groups, murder squads. We had room in the dock from the Nuremberg trial for 24. We could only try 24 defendants. I originally indicted 24, and then one of them died, the other one got sick. We ended up with 22. But here were the reports of 3,000 men, each one directly involved, planning, participating, and executing mass murder, including thousands of children. And of the 3,000, I selected 22, 24, based upon their rank. I had 6 SS generals and their education. Most of them, many of them, had doctor degrees. One of them, who was responsible for the Babi Yar job that I mentioned, the killing 33,771 Jews, he had 2 doctorates, Dr. Rush. So the notion that these are wild beasts is wrong. It's totally wrong. Ohlendorf, my lead defendant, was fairly honest. He was the father of 5 children, Dr. Ohlendorf, doctors in economics. And when asked, why did you kill all these people? He said, well, it was self-defense. What do you mean self-defense? Germany attacked Poland, Norway, Holland, Belgium, France. Nobody was attacking Germany. He said, yeah, but we knew that the Russians, the Soviets, planned to attack us. Therefore, it was necessary for us in self-defense to attack first. Well, the notion of preemptive self-defense, which is what it's called in English anyway, was considered by 3 American judges who issued a very detailed opinion when they were all found guilty. And it was explained that this is no legal defense. What would happen to the world if everybody was entitled to say, well, I thought my neighbor was going to attack me, and I saw he had a gun. So I went in and I killed him, and I killed his wife, and I killed his children. What kind of a world would we have? Because Ohlendorf explained it was necessary to kill all the children too. Because if they grew up and knew what had happened to their parents, they would be enemies of Germany, and he was interested in a long time security of his country. And why did you kill all the gypsies? Well, nobody trusts the gypsies. They play both sides of the street. So you have to get rid of them too. And of course their children too. As if to say, are you stupid? Of course we had to do that. I went down to talk to Ohlendorf after he was sentenced to death. I had never talked to any of my defendants during the trial, I mean before the trial, or after the trial for that matter. I presented the documents and the evidence and said, here, that's it. I didn't call a single witness. I didn't need it. The best evidence is the contemporaneous documentary, top secret report signed by the defendants. That's a beautiful case from a prosecutor's point of view. But I went down to talk to Ohlendorf because he had been fairly honest in his statement. I knew he was the father of 5 children. It was clear to me that he was going to hang. And I thought, well, it's a human gesture. Maybe he wants me to give a message to his wife, his children. So I went down and I said to him in German, is it anything I can do for you, Mr. Ohlendorf? And he said, you'll see that I was right. And he went to his death believing that he was absolutely right, and that was also certainly the opinion of practically all of the accused at Nuremberg. The saddest thing for me in my experience in Germany during those early days was never did I hear a word of regret or remorse from anybody. The few Germans who said they were sorry, they were the ones who were arrested and were themselves victimized by the Nazis. And there were also such Germans. So that was my Nuremberg experience in short. And where did it leave me? Well, I was soon approached by representatives of various Jewish organizations. And they said they had managed to get a law passed by military government requiring stolen property to be returned to their former owners, because no Jew was allowed to own property. And if their property was taken under duress during the Nazi period and had not been claimed, either because the owner was no longer alive or had been killed, it would go to a successor organization. That's another organization which would act, instead of the state keeping the property, would recover the property and use it for the benefit of the survivors. That sounded like a pretty good idea, and I accepted that responsibility. There were no precedents whatsoever. And I soon set up the organizations to deal with that. First, to file the claims, 163,000 claims, which filed for heirless property. I then set up a legal aid society to help the victims, and at the same time was the legal counsel to a team. Most of this was all teamwork, negotiating a treaty with the West German government, which would provide compensation to the survivors based upon proof of specific losses. Well, that sounded like a very fair thing to do. What I didn't know was that it was impossible to do. But I did it anyway. And I'll tell you, I got into the habit of doing the impossible. So if we come to talk about creating a peaceful world and so on, it looks impossible. Don't tell me that. I always do the impossible. And what made it impossible was the houses had been bombed. The person who was in possession said, I paid off the mortgage. The British came and they bombed the house. I had it repaired. The boiler was put in. Where's my money? And then on top of that, there was a currency conversion for for 10 Deutsche Reichsmarks, they got one Deutsche Mark, so it looked like he was getting only 1/10. I don't want to go into the details of it. When we got through, they said, Hitler should have killed you too. And it was a very, very difficult job. You want to get the details, you can look at some of my books. However, so I've gone through the first three phases. One, winning the war. Of course, Patton could not have done it without me, even though I admit I was mostly hiding under a truck. When the war was over, as a sergeant of infantry, they gave me an honorable discharge and 5 battle stars. I said, what is that for? And they said, well, you were not killed or wounded in any of the 5 major battles of the war. I thought that was a good idea. Why do you glorify those who got killed? You should glorify those who didn't get killed. So I got my credential that way. Anyway, so we had finished the first phase. The war had been won. The second phase, trying the criminals, had also partially been won. We could only do a sampling. You can never catch all the criminals or try them all. We don't have that much time. We would be still sitting in Germany trying criminals if we tried to make complete justice for everybody who committed massive crimes. So that part had been finished. I had launched the restitution program, compensation program. It was going quite well. It cost the West German government billions of dollars, even though they were not in existence when the crimes occurred. including a payment of $3 billion to Israel, which was a state which didn't exist when the crimes occurred, but they were compensated for having given relief to the survivors for the injuries caused by the Germans. So we had all kinds of legal theories to justify it. But basically, it was the feeling of the Catholic Chancellor, Konrad Adenauer. As he put it, terrible crimes have been committed in the name of the German people, and that obliges us to try to make amends. And so we had a combination there of indescribable horrors and crimes, and yet a recognition of a moral impulse to try to do something with the law in order to, we can't make up for it, but in order to at least show some concern. Well, I was having trouble feeding my family on what I was earning for all these three different corporations that I was running, and we had a staff, to give you some idea of the magnitude. My staff was over 1,000 people. The German government had an army of bureaucrats checking out the validity of the claims, doctors examining and re-examining the claimant, and so on. Very complicated. I'm happy to say that those problems are not yet over, because in the Control Council laws and in the Rome Statute and the ICC Statute, there is a provision, Article 75, that the victims are entitled to rehabilitation, restitution, and compensation. How that's going to work out has not yet been figured out. And I stayed away from that because I had enough to do with the next problem, the most important problem. And that's where you come in, and Baltasar Garzón comes in too. How do you prevent it from happening again? That is the problem. We have lived in a world of horrors, indescribable problems, human problems, legal problems, social problems, all of that. And the main thing is, what do you do? And I had been deeply involved in those problems, and I suppose because of that, I felt that I ought to try to do something about it. I would try to create a more humane and peaceful world. I was then almost 50 years old, and I had been practicing law in New York for a while with Telford Taylor, who we were law partners. He had the same problem going home after many years. Law firms wanted to know, how many clients do you bring? I had clients, they had nothing but a tattoo on their arm. So I didn't do so well. However, I thought my kids by that time were grown, educated. I would dedicate myself to trying to prevent again happening what I had seen and all the problems. Well, how do you do that? I had never taken a course in international law in my life, still haven't. But I began to study the subject. I was a careful student. I went to the libraries in New York, in the United Nations, in Geneva, in the League of Nations. I read everything on the subject. I went to all the meetings at the United Nations, at the Legal Committee and the International Law Commission meetings, and pretty soon I got a pretty good idea of how the world runs, and I began to write books. First two volumes, Defining International Aggression, two volumes. So if somebody tells me I don't know about aggression, they better read my two volumes first. The next two, Creating an International Criminal Court. We have the court. Everybody said it couldn't happen. They said it couldn't define aggression either, but had that. And the next two volumes were on enforcing international law, and we haven't begun that yet. Then I wrote another big volume, which Kofi Annan thought was quite good. He said it was represented everything the United Nations stands for, and it does. And all of these books are available free on my website. I don't sell books. And you don't have to read them all. I'll give you the gist of it in one sentence or two. The world depends upon three basic components for peaceful society. It must have laws to define what's permissible and what's not permissible. It must have courts to decide whether people have broken those laws or to serve as a forum to settle those differences. And it must have a system of effective enforcement. Those three components, laws, courts, and enforcement, exist in every civilized society, whether it be a city or a town or a country or a world. The world in which we live has come along pretty well with the laws. When I went to school, there was no such thing as humanitarian law, unheard of. Today, every school in the world knows about humanitarian law, and we are beginning to move, with problems, of course. The next thing, courts, International Criminal Court, unheard of, non-existent. Today, we have the International Criminal Court in The Hague, we have the temporary courts set up by the Security Council, we have additional international courts in other parts of the world, and growing, with problems, of course. And I want to note, and the enforcement field, however, is practically totally lacking. We don't have any enforcement. The United Nations Charter, which came out the same time as the Nuremberg Trials, pictured an improved world. The court would determine who were the aggressors and who committed crimes against humanity and would deter those crimes, and the United Nations, with its requirements for disarmament, for an international military force, for social justice, that would be the institute where they all came together under supervision by those who had the power, the Security Council, and it would be a peaceful world. Well, that idea lasted about 3 minutes, I think, maybe a week, I don't know, and absolutely failed. The United Nations Charter says, we the peoples, plural, in order to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war. That's the primary purpose of it. Well, they absolutely failed. There are wars going on all over the world. We don't use the word war anymore. It's an armed aggression or something else. Anyway, so this ideal scheme that we had when I was still a young man, failed. It failed. And why did it fail? Well, you're going to have a week here of discussions, and I'm sure that this will be gone into in greater detail, and I don't have to go into it now. So let me just go back now to where we are, and how does one untrained little guy set about to try to save the world? Maybe a encourage you to say, if he can do it, so can I. I hope you'll be encouraged in that direction. I wrote these books. I went to meetings at the United Nations. I lobbied all the delegates. I gave them little pamphlets, and I have some with me still here today, new ones, up to date. Remind me to give you some. pretty soon I got to be pretty well known. They saw me coming, they say, here comes Mr. Aggression. Well, it wasn't that easy, because the big powers, those who had the power, and this goes back to ancient days, don't want to give it up. And those who don't have the power, don't have the power, they can't change it. That is the world described in Thucydides' volume on the Peloponnesian Wars 2,000 years before Christ. And for the purpose of the translator, the Peloponnesian Wars. Forget about it. 2,000 years before Christ, this was the proceedings, and it still has considerable power today. But this notion of sovereignty, which came in 1680, whereby states, the local states, have been killing each other periodically in Italy and France and Spain. They said, no, we're going to have a new system. You can be a sovereign state. Whatever you do in that state is your business, and whatever it is in our state, no interference in our internal affairs. The king can do no wrong. And that was a system which worked for a number of years, as long as the king was going to do the fighting. But they got smart and they hired some of the knights to do the fighting, and pretty soon the knights didn't want to do it, and they passed it on to the people to do the fighting, and they didn't want to do it, and they wanted me to do the fighting. I don't want to do the fighting. So the system has changed. The days of absolute state sovereignty is absolutely obsolete. That gives the translator time to translate that. The notion of an absolutely sovereign state is absolutely obsolete and absurd. We live in an interdependent world where you cannot do anything without international controls and direction. You cannot fly an airplane, you cannot ship a pound of wheat, everything is dependent one upon each other. And I wrote another little book on that theme. It was for public consumption. It's not two volumes, it's a short little book called Planethood. And the name signifies we no longer can rely upon nationhood or neighborhood as being our unit of concern. We must all be concerned about one little planet Earth. And we are all inhabitants of this small planet. And we must learn to use the resources on that planet for the benefit of all of humankind, regardless of their race or their creed. That was the plea I made in Nuremberg when I was 27 years old. And then there's an interesting event happened just a couple of years ago when the new International Criminal Court was created in The Hague, which everybody said to me, Ben, give up, you'll never get it. It'll never happen. And I said, I don't care, I'm going to try. Well, when the court was established, and a friend of Baltasar and mine became the chief prosecutor from Argentina, Luis Moreno Ocampo, and he got to the end of the case, he sent me a note and said, Ben, we'd like you to come and do the closing statement for the prosecution. And I did. And I was happy to do that. And he said, remember what you said in Nuremberg. It's a crime against humanity. And we are seeking control of human behavior by law. And I repeated the same argument at his request that I had made when I was 27. That was my second and now the end of my criminal career. I had only two cases, one when I was 27, the second one when I was 92. So you see, it's not a very flourishing business, although its business is picking up. All right, so there you have it. Now let me come to the problems which are on your program here today. It says here, a difficult balance of principles, political interests, and local contexts. Let me just address that briefly, because I only have 5 or 10 minutes at most left.
Yes.
The world as I saw it and as experienced it, nobody could fire me because nobody hired me. And I could speak the truth, which is a very rare commodity, particularly when you're dealing with diplomats. I'm not saying they're all a bunch of liars, but most of them do, what I could hear. So I was focusing on the supreme international crime. The International Military Tribunal in Nuremberg had held that aggression is the supreme international crime. It was then called a crime against peace. Because in wartime, all the other crimes are committed. Rape, murder, pillage, arson, all the other crimes are committed under the cover of war. And I know that was true because I saw it. There's never been a war without rape. And it's a prize of war. When the Russians got into Berlin, they had a tough fight. I mean, I could understand they're going out of their minds, but no woman was safe, no one. And I came in there very shortly thereafter. I was trying to catch Hitler. And they were happy to see an American, said, please protect me. And that's the reason we did not list rape as a crime in the charter of the International Military Tribunal, because the Russians would have objected. They would have had a perfect case against their soldiers. But we did correct that when General Taylor came in. He was also a Harvard Law graduate, became a professor of law at Columbia University. Rape is listed as a crime. And it has been one of the more important, the sex crimes and war have always gone hand in hand. So there we are. I was working on getting aggression condemned, and I ran into very big problems because the big powers were not ready to surrender their presumed sovereign right to go to war whenever they felt like it, and nobody would check it. So one of the basic fallacies which I have observed in all of these conflicts between nations is that each party believes he is right. Ohlendorf thought he was right, he was justified. The other side says they are murderers. The one side says they're terrorists, the other side says they're it's heroic. And as long as there is no third party, to wit a court or equivalent, to determine, then the two protagonists, the two opponents, have nothing else to do but to fight it out between them. War is inevitable if we have built the institutions that we need to settle serious differences without recourse to military force. We haven't created such an institution. There is none in the world with that power. So it's lacking. And every effort which is made to understand that we have to have universal principles which govern everybody and agencies which enforce it, the laws and the courts and the enforcement, you're going to continue to see the barbarism and chaos that we are now witnessing every day, today, in various parts of the world. So it's not something you can do easily. Of course, politics plays a key role here. And I have been concerned about that, very much so. And I have some suggestions as to how we should proceed at this point. The definition of aggression has been amended. I have a picture of me with the committee of the United Nations, which reached the consensus definition of aggression. It's one of my books published. The chairman, Bengt Brons of Sweden, called me down from the balcony and he said, "Ben, you come and stand with us because this is your definition." I don't want to assume blame for that definition, but I pushed them that they would have one. So I'm on the picture. Consensus definition of aggression approved by the General Assembly, accepted by the General Assembly. And I've heard 1,000 times from diplomats of all countries, aggression has never been defined, we can't punish aggression. They don't know what they're talking about. They haven't read my two volumes, I don't blame them. But so it's been a tough fight and they have not been persuaded. The United States, which is a great democracy, and I am a very patriotic American because I know what opportunities I got as a poor immigrant boy in the United States, which I would not have had any place else in the world. And I'm grateful to the United States. What, in the sense of Tom Paine, who was one of our great American patriots in the American Revolution, I will support my country when it's right. But when I see they are wrong, it's my patriotic duty to try to make it right. And so I've had a tough time trying to make it right, because the powers that exist in our political structure are such that even the President of the United States, who I know some of them were in favor, Jimmy Carter was one of them, I'll go down the list, but we are a divided country, a centrist country. The President gets elected by a majority of 2% or 1%. If he antagonizes the people on the right wing who believed and still believe, and I cannot change them, that we are the greatest, we are the strongest, we are the most powerful, we must use that power to protect our interests, and that's our primary responsibility, they control enough votes so that the President who says, "No, we must consider the needs of other people, in, whether it be in Timbuktu or whether it be in Afghanistan or any place else, he's going to lose the election. So it's a political influence which is corrupting the behavior of the other states. They just can't do it, and they can't get it through the Congress. They passed a law declaring war on Holland if the court in Holland dared to arrest an American. It was crazy. And this was all right-wing stuff. So you have the political interests, and you have economic interests as well playing a role in all of this. This is not just something in a theoretical academic background. They are big contributors to various campaigns. Eisenhower, the President of the United States, the great hero, my supreme commander in World War II, said, beware the military-industrial complex. And I'm quoting, he said, in a very real sense, the world can no longer rely on force. It must turn to the rule of law. This is from a military commander. I lectured in West Point a few weeks ago, and I tell the soldiers there, the young cadets, I am here because I don't like to see you coming home in body bags or in parts, and I don't know of any better way to protect you and to eliminate this stupid thing that we now do. The world today, if two leaders cannot agree, how do they settle it? They send young people, like some of you, out to kill other young people whom they don't even know, who never did them any harm, may never have done any harm to anybody, and you try to kill them. And that's the idea of settling it. I think that's insane. And then we spend billions of dollars with nuclear weapons in arsenals all over the United States and other countries targeted at cities in the former Soviet Union. We do that today. And I have it on the reliable authority of two very distinguished people who became my friends after they left office. One was the head of the CIA, Admiral Stan Turner, and the other one was the former Secretary of Defense, Robert McNamara. And in this discussion with a small group, McNamara asked the head of the CIA, would you say our nuclear policy is insane? He said, of course. So it's not just my opinion. I have just two leading guys. They were both retired. In the office, they wouldn't dare. I tried it with the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. He brought the problem to the State Department. So it's tied in. Now let me close, because we're getting to my time frame here. The idea of universal jurisdiction is an old idea. It goes back to piracy. There was a time when trade depended upon ships moving, and the pirates made the trade impossible. And so they didn't pass a law. We had no international lawmaking, as we have not today, except treaties. They declared that pirates are hostis humani generi. I'm not trying to impress you with my Latin, because my Latin is no better than my Spanish. But what it meant was, they are enemies of all mankind. And therefore, anybody who catches a pirate, no matter where or when, can take them, and all of them, the cook included, put out a plank on the side of the ship, and they walk off the plank, and the sharks can eat them. I'm not suggesting we feed everybody to the sharks, but it's the idea that there are times in society when it's important, whether the laws are written or not written, where they all understand those crimes are not to be tolerated because they jeopardize the safety and well-being of everybody. Sovereignty does not belong to the state anymore. It belongs to the people. And the people will be asserting that sovereignty. And they are asserting that sovereignty now. So we're beginning to see a change. There's going to be a change, a shift in balance. Whether we can make that change before we get blown up by nuclear weapons are obsolete. I'm not worried about them anymore, except expense. But we now have the power from outer space, cyberspace, to cut off the electrical grid of any city on Earth. Imagine Madrid, all the electricity goes out. You wouldn't hear this lecture, for one thing, but everybody would soon be dead. And we have that power today with no fuss, no muss, no fuss. And I got that from a general when we were having breakfast together, and I said, what are you working on? He said, I'm working on that problem. And I said, what's the problem? His problem is the Russians can do it and so can the Chinese. So we live in a dangerous world. And anything which is done to affirm universal principles saying these are crimes and they should be treated as crimes no matter where they occur, what difference does it make? What the boundary is, whether it's Hungary or Romania. It makes no difference. Some people are being killed. And if they are killed, then I have argued that it is a crime against humanity. Forget about aggression. Keep working, trying to get them to do it. Ratify these decisions we made by consensus in Kampala, saying we have an agreed new definition of aggression. All you have to do is ratify. 30 nations have to do that. Then it'll maybe become binding. Never over the Americans' present attitude. So anyway, let me conclude by saying that the purpose of this conference is very significant. If we can begin to think in terms not of the boundaries, not of the printed text, but of the universal human principles which make it possible for everybody, regardless of their race or their creed or their belief, to live in relative peace, that's all they want. There are some crazies who want glory and who want to, you know, but that's a extreme. The basic wish of all the people is to live in peace, and this conference, and I am here because I believe that, moves in that direction. It will not be easy. There'll be opposition from those in power. But in the long run, I believe that the impossible will become possible, and I want to thank you and congratulate you and say I thank you all. Thank you very much.
Questions for Benjamin. Benjamin, the first question is whether the principle of obedience of life was called upon in the Nuremberg trials, either as a principle for defense or as a principle for the defense of the defendants. Let me rephrase that. Did defendants use the duty of obedience of their orders to reject a responsibility of, or liability? Did they argue that they were just following orders? And second, why were death penalties applied instead of life sentences?
If I understand the question, there's two parts. First, whether about the fairness of the trials, and also about sentencing. The fairness of the trials was incredible, in the sense that every effort was made to give the defendants every piece of evidence that we had that would be used in the trial against them at least 30 days in advance. They could choose their own sentence, their own defense counsel, who were at complete liberty to make whatever arguments, some of which I thought were ridiculous, in defense of their clients. The second part of your question, as I understand it, regards sentencing, why we impose the death sentences. Let me say on the first part, an example of the unfairness of the trial was apparent in my own case where I was the chief prosecutor. I had 24 defendants and reduced to 22. And I had prosecutors to help me, prosecuting lawyers, three others besides myself. On the other side, each of the 22 defendants was entitled to a defense lawyer and an assistant of his own choice, 44 lawyers. So we had on the other side 44 experienced German lawyers who knew all the facts. And as prosecutors, we had one chief prosecutor and three additional prosecutors who were cast off from other trials. It would have been ordinarily considered a very unbalanced court. The didn't bother me at all because I had something more important than defense counsel. I had the documentary proof signed by the defendants. On the death penalty, I did not ask for the death penalty, although I proved that these were crimes against humanity, and I made my plea of humanity to law. I didn't ask for the death penalty because I couldn't imagine anything which would balance the lives of the million and more victims of these mass murderers as against the handful of these defendants. I thought arguing for a plea of humanity to law would protect all of humankind in the future against this type of abuse, because the victims were murdered because they didn't share the race and the religion or the ideology of their executioners. I thought that was quite horrible then. It still is the practice in many places today. I think it's quite horrible now. And that explains why I continue to press for it, for an improvement in the law. It's not that I'm against death penalty in principle, but if there were anybody who deserved the death penalty, it was my defendants. But there was something more important than getting rid of this particular criminal.
Una pregunta para Paulo.
During our discussions, we would rather have some more light. So, Benjamin, there is a question here for you with a reference to the notion of a preventive self-defense, which was argued or used as an argument by German defendants. The question goes as follows. In the United States today, the term self-defense or preventive self-defense, has it been used as a justification for the intervention of the United States in other countries? Because it seems to have been used. Is there a difference between the two? Or what are the similarities?
That's a very important question. I repeat the question. It regards the presumed self-defense or preventive self-defense argument of the defendants in many of the German trials, whether that is a justifiable defense, and has the United States used that defense in different situations. The defense itself, as I indicated, was rejected by three American lawyers, and I'm sorry to say that in the policy put out by the Pentagon periodically, the Quadrennial Defense Review, they have not precluded putative self-defense or preventive self-defense, as you've called it, as a possible weapon. So the Pentagon reserves to itself the right to use the same argument which was used by defendants accused by the United States. The title of the lawsuit or the prosecution was the United States of America versus Ohlendorf et al., Benjamin Ferencz, prosecutor. So as the prosecutor, I am less than pleased to see that in the American manual, what is permissible, at least was, I haven't seen the one in the last couple of years, by the United States. Whether it has actually been used, no. It's only applicable when you are defending yourself against an armed attack. It is not stretchable, even then it's not permissible, but you certainly can't stretch it to say that if I believe you are attacking somebody else, then I have the right to intervene in order to defend them, because I think they're about to launch such an attack. The United States has not gone that far. And again, I want to caution. One should not speak about the United States. The United States is a great democracy, and as a result, it has people with different points of view, and that's as it should be. And the points of view, if they're serious, deserve to be respected. It doesn't mean you have to agree with them, But at least you have to hear them out and decide. That's what happens at a trial when they make their case. So it's not the United States. There are some people in the United States who are far right, and there are some people who are far left. And the great majority simply want to live in peace and harmony. So I always hear the United States did this and the United States did that when they do things which I don't agree with. But it's not the United States. It's particular individuals. And we have not yet learned that you cannot kill an ideology with a gun. So the policy is made by the Pentagon, because everybody loves the soldiers, everybody loves the military, and the President of the United States doesn't dare say anything which might show any lack of love or respect for the military. But there are situations which we have not quite grasped yet, that if a person is ready to give up his life and kill for his particular ideology, whether it be religion or nationalism or economic, there's nothing you can do to prevent it. All you have to do is, all the best you can do is to go to trial and make the arguments to the public and let the public decide for themselves whether they support that policy. And I'm convinced that when you got into that kind of a situation, the American public, most of the American public, would be in favor of the ideals which have been expressed here today and which are represented by the attempt to broaden the applicability of humanitarian principles and make them binding law.
Hay muchas más preguntas, pero
we have plenty of other questions, but we have to stick to the allocated time. However, I have two more questions to address to you. One of our audience members asks whether the impunity of thousands of members of the SS or the action groups or death squads has had any influence on the of the resurging of neo-Nazism around the world. Second, after everything you have gone through, do you still believe that these crimes can be stopped? Do you still believe in the end of impunity?
Let me begin with the end question first. When you say believe in, I certainly believe that we should not grant impunity or immunity, as we are now doing for some of the most horrendous crimes, such as the crime of aggression, which has been my specialty. No one can be tried by the International Criminal Court because they say falsely it hasn't been adequately defined, and because they don't want to be tried. And the question whether it has led to increase in Nazi sentiments. I wouldn't exaggerate the Nazi sentiments. It's a very small group. There will always be people who have views which are different from the rest. That's normal, and we shouldn't panic about it. But we should recognize that in a free democracy, the judicial process enables people to make their arguments in public, and the public will decide. In the last analysis, the greatest enforcement power is the will of the people themselves. Small fanatic groups of right or the left, I hope, will never dominate the political scene. And as people get educated by programs such as this, the life expectancy of such far right and far left groups is very limited.